So while we try to find the presentation, thanks for the introduction. I'll talk slightly differently from what we've had so far, discussions about IoT and specific things with technology. I'm just going to try to talk about overall clean energy. And in this context of the career, I got reminded about one of my managers from Intel who used to talk about you take up a job initially, but like Ravi mentioned, jobs can be transient. What you really want is a number of jobs which link together to form a career, but you are most productive, you're most happy with your life if you actually have a calling, where you are trying to do something which is you are passionate about, you want to do it, regardless of who's paying the you know, the money for you to do it, or what kind of job you're doing. You are trying to do it in an area where you enjoy. We've seen about IoT, we've seen about data analytics. These are areas which have got huge opportunities for each and every one of us to do a variety of jobs, establish different kind of careers. But now we'll switch gears to something in the clean tech area. We hope to find the presentation which I put there. But it'll start off with a very busy set of slides. And the first one, there we go.
Sorry.
Oh, no. Thank you. So we are all from IIT. So we should be, I'm expecting each and every one of us to know all the numbers in this busy slide. Now, the main point here of this slide is, why are we talking about clean energy? And the answer right there is global greenhouse gases. And this picture here is one of the recent summary of what happens when sunlight comes in, and a lot of it is reflected back by the cloud, some of it is reflected by the surface. What is reflected from, what is surface radiation, a lot of it gets reflected back by the greenhouse gases. And that is the blanket Earth is encompassed with, and that's the reason we are getting climate change. And it's proven now that man-made climate change is important. So that's why clean energy is important. We want to reduce the man-made thing. Now, one aspect here of energy is today, or 2015, 50% of the energy consumption is in the OECD, the rich countries, America, Europe, and Japan, and Korea, and all of those, about 50%. However, in the next 25 years or so, the overall global energy consumption will grow by 1.5x. But the consumption will significantly increase in the non-OECD countries, India, China. They will all grow. So this, if this was 50%, these are OECD. Now the OECD slice becomes smaller. Most of the generation, consumption and generation is going to take place in the new countries, and that's the opportunity. That's the opportunity for establishing a career in clean tech, because a lot of new addition has to take place of capacity, and that will take place places like India. So just looking at India, 60% odd is coal. Renewable energy and hydro today add up to less than 30%. However, the good news is, I'll skip this and come back. Good news is, we have the opportunity to change that. So, switching a little bit to clean energy in general, there are a variety of areas where work has to be done, is being done, in both research and research and development, in deployment, in creating new businesses, creating new business models. A lot of work is taking place. But first thing which I want to touch upon is need for energy efficiency. So clean energy includes, the first step is energy efficiency. And I call it the first step is, if the customer uses 1 joule lesser of energy, the generator, as a matter of fact, has to generate 3 joules lesser of energy. That is because there's a huge loss, about 60-odd% loss from what you generate to what you'll actually land up consuming. This is a very simplistic picture, but basically we have to therefore look at how well we consume. So energy efficiency is a big business model, is a big need. We talked about IoT. There's a need for making sure that we do not waste energy, and we therefore have to be very smart about it, use all the analytics, all the understanding and intelligence to reduce the consumption. So that's the first part. The next comment, you know, that energy efficiency, you could look at overall, this is for US, there are lots of generating paths and there are lots of consuming paths. How do we build the efficiency into the overall system is critical. You could consider this as a energy grid, or you could limit to even the electricity grid and consider the opportunities in a smart grid portion. Now, yes, many of us might snigger. I'd be happy if the grid in India or in Bangalore was stable enough that I could know when it was coming. Forget about smart grid part of it. But as a matter of fact, embedding information technology, embedding IoT, data analytics, etc., is critical for getting a smart grid to work, getting us as a consumer to get a continuous firm power, firm energy. We have to be able to we have to be able to take energy from solar, from coal, from petroleum, mix it, and still ensure that we are all able to run with a good air conditioning and stable power here. And only then that could take place. So smart grid is another big area for opportunities, for business, for careers, for growth for us. Now, switching therefore now to the kind of energies on the renewable side, and I'm just giving opportunities to the scales out here. These are the predicted growth for wind, and I'm just 24 odd gigawatts now is what somebody is saying with the new policy scenario in 2015, expected to go to 66 gigawatt, but if there was a much more push, an advanced scenario, you could get about 200 gigawatts of wind to be installed. Wind energy has been there for a while, but a lot more R&D has to take place. It has to be much more efficient, much more stable, be able to place windmills in areas where the wind is not strong enough, yet generate. All of that has to take place, and that is part of what opportunity exists. For the solar, and which is the area where I'm working in, and you'll see more foils in that for that reason, just because of my background in this. Utility scale power right now from solar is around 5 gigawatt installed in India. It's expected to go to 40 gigawatts in the next 5 to 7 years. 10x increase. So there's a lot of opportunity there. There's a lot of opportunity in the R&D portion of it. There's a lot of opportunity in business aspects of it. That comment about how it will go to 40 gigawatt, the government has laid out plans to try to get 40 gigawatt installed on rooftops and 60 gigawatts installed on large scale projects. 100 gigawatts, $100 billion of investment to be put, which requires a lot of innovation. And innovation consists not only of technology, R&D is critical to make it happen, But innovation consists of business models, finance, and everything else. What has happened over the past few years, and this is a little difficult to read, so I'll just read it aloud. This is the power, the rate at which solar power was being purchased by the Indian government in 2010, 12.7 rupees. Progressively come down by the time of 2014, it had come down to 8 rupees. Now, these are the recent trends in 2015-16. The latest rates are at 4.8 rupees. 4.3 also was signed, but that company has gone belly up from a global standpoint, SunEdison. So that has actually poisoned the well, but nonetheless, there's been a progressive decline in the cost of solar energy. And that has come about due to development of technology, development of capacity, and improvement in the financial models, and innovation in how the energy is being delivered or sold to the consumer or in the market. So solar energy now is within 30 to 40% of coal energy. And if commodity pricing was to go back up, etc., then maybe the oil or the fossil fuel, coal included, would increase. And solar will continue to decrease. And the expectation is sometime in 2017, 18, 19 time frame, they would cross over. So I'll just recap. There is the energy efficiency, LEDs, controls, IoT, data analytics to make sure that we do not consume more than what we need. There is the need for new sources of energy, renewable, wind, and solar. We just looked at how they are both progressing along the path of reducing cost. But there's also the need for a smartness integrated into the overall grid to make sure that information technology, computing controls, and energy are combined together to give a lot of improved lifestyle for everybody. That's my little spiel on smart energy for you. I'm open to any questions. I think we have still a few minutes remaining.
Yeah. I'm Sriyari here. You heard of solid oxide fuel cells?
Sorry?
Solid oxide fuel cells.
Yes.
So how does this challenge this solar energy? Or how? What is the market about it?
Sure. Problem with both solar and wind is that they are what people like to call infirm. They are not there 24 hours as a stable source. Storage and something like the gas fire or the fuel cells can have a big advantage there in terms of able to provide clean energy, clean burning fuel to provide the energy. So solid oxide fuel cells, Bloom Energy was one, with much splash, etc., are doing a good task there, but their costs are still a little higher and not competitive enough yet. A lot of technology development has to take place to move from 70% non-renewable, energy, and still, consume much more energy. We have to use all kinds of technologies, all kind of cleaner technologies to move away from coal. Coal is the dirtiest, but it's the cheapest. To move away from coal, we have to do what we can and roll up our sleeves on all kind of technologies.
Now, this wind energy and solar energy, as you said, it is not continuous. Okay, the need for me may be some X kilowatts, but my solar energy is producing X plus another Y kilowatts. So what happens to this Y?
So typically, you do not want to, well, depends on what we're trying to do. If you're connected to the grid, the why, if you're producing excessive energy, you sell it back to the grid. There's policies all over, Delhi, Karnataka, Maharashtra, where net metering is taking place, that if your excessive production can be sold back to the grid. On the other hand, if you are not on the grid, you store it in a battery and then use it at a later time. So energy is important. Just to put it in context, for the GDP growth of 2%, this is from historical data, global economy, etc. For 2% growth of GDP, you need to have the energy consumption in that country grow by 1%. So if we are trying to shoot for 6, 8, whatever percent, we have to have that much extra energy generation capacity growth happening. So there's a lot more to happen here in India, and that's a very important thing. Yes, please.
The efficiency of a solar cell right now is only 15%. And don't you think that effort should be emphasized in R&D?
Good point. So the theoretical efficiency of a single junction solar cell is around 30%. The commercially available solar cells are now reaching up to 20%. But the efficiency per se is less of importance than the cost of making these solar cells. And I'll just quickly add why. Typically, there's sufficient area available for the capacity which you want to utilize, So if you want 1 kilowatt, you need something like 100 square feet. Efficiency affects that number. If you, instead of 15%, you are at 20%, instead of 100 square feet, you need 70 square feet. If instead of 20%, you are at 30%, you need 50 square feet. Most cases, unless it is a small, rooftop kind of thing, most cases there is area available today. There is not enough, cost is the bigger factor for most people to decide whether they want to install solar. So that is the part right now for that. But efficiency and cost are both needed to be worked on. There's a lot of work going on in IIT Bombay, for instance. NCPRE is based right there, and it's the leading for PV work taking place in India. There's a lot of work going on there, and R&D is the first part of the full cycle of how we can leverage the opportunity we have to go to clean energy in India. So there's a lot to be done, you're right.
Can you talk about the opportunities in this space that are government funded or government initiatives? I've heard about all these, the smart city projects, smart grid projects, various rural projects, to make villages self-sufficient and so on. So what, can you talk about some of those?
So the government is very much committed to improve the state of affairs, in both in terms of availability of power and in the nature of the power which is being produced or used. So that, the solar statement which I just showed as to try to install 100 gigawatts in the next 7 years or 6 years, that's one set of opportunity. Wind has a similar goal for that. Smart cities and the need to try to improve the energy efficiency is another key initiative from the government bodies. I don't exactly know which website, but there are lots of Bureau of Energy Efficiency kind of driven things. LEDs, for instance, are there's a incentives driven as well as mandate driven use to go to LED lights, etc. So there's a lot of government initiative on that. But I am of the opinion as to government job is just to remove the obstacles business's job is to go create or do the business. So right now, solar is at a point that I should be able to compete with the grid directly. So it's the business innovations and technology innovations to go do that is what we should consider that it should be the focus for most of us. Government initiatives, government subsidies are a slow incoming and laden with their own overheads, which sometimes makes it worse. So that's my view on this right now.
Sir.
Yes, please.
I worked for Tata BP Solar in the year 97-98. Now, at that time, the problem was the same. You know, if you make cells from crystalline silicon, the price is very high. So people cannot afford it. Now, there was a lot of work being done at that point in time on amorphous silicon thin film cells. Now, it's almost 20 years since that time, so I'd like to know what is the state of that kind of approach, because the costs would be cut by a factor of probably 5.
Sure. So let me just quickly give you, I presume you moved on from solar field into something different. Things have changed significantly. The cost of solar cells or solar modules was close to $5 a watt in 2006. Today, you can get them at $0.5 a watt. And part of it is some technical improvement. Part of it is scale of the industry. You know, the cost goes down roughly by 10% for doubling of the global capacity is roughly what it is people have looked at. The global capacity has gone to now around 60 gigawatts per year installation from what was something like, you know, total install base at that time was less than a gigawatt. Just like in rest of semiconductor world, where you know there was in silicon technology for ICs, it could never be pushed out by gallium arsenide and other things, despite other advantages. Same thing here. Silicon is entrenched as the solar leader because it's a simple, straightforward technology which is cheap and performing very well out there. Yes, please. Yeah, we are done with that. Thank you.